Thank you very much. So thank you very much, everybody. I would like to also thanks the organizer for inviting me again in Barcelona, my country. And the title of my presentation concerns the efficient simulation based on advanced model order reduction. So I will start with a short introduction, and after we are moving to two applications. One of them will be detailed tomorrow in the presentation of Diego in the session of model order reduction. So first of all, also introduce my co-authors, some ones that are coming from Ecole Centrale de Nantes, others like Elias Cueto from Zaragoza, Antonio and Pedro from Barcelona, and also colleagues in the Saint-Étienne that are collaborating with me in some of the applications that I'm presenting now. So the main aim of my presentation is to illustrate the construction of parametric solutions. What is a parametric solution? A parametric solution is when you have a model, you try to solve this model for any choice of the parameters in the model. Why? Because you are spending a little bit of time offline, absolutely offline, and as soon as you solve for all possible scenarios and you store this in your computer, after online, you need only to have access to this parametric solution to particularize, and you have access to the solution. So the idea is to decompose the simulation in two steps. One offline, in which you compute everything, and after, obviously, you need to use it online, very, very fast, in general, in real time. So we are very concerned by real-time constraints. So in order to perform this, there is nothing new. From the point of view, conceptual point of view, everything is easy. We have a model, and in this model there are a series of parameters. Some parameters concern the model itself, material parameters, for example. Other concerns the geometry of my problem, of my domain. Another concerns the boundary conditions, the loads in a general sense. All these are parameters. This means that before running your simulation code, you need to introduce all these parameters, you push the button, you wait, and you obtain the solution. So you obtain the solution related to all the parameters that you fix before the simulation. But now, obviously, if you change the parameter, you need to solve again. You change any material parameter, geometrical or any load, and you need to introduce this again in your code. You need to push the button, you need to wait, and you obtain the solution. So everything is conceptually very easy, but from a point of view of computation, this is quite difficult, because today the online simulation, the online solution by using finite elements of a problem, takes minutes, hours, days, and so we cannot emphasize this kind of approach if you are interested by real time. In this case, we need to change the scenario. So one idea is to compute the parametric solution. This is very nice. I could compute any possible solution of my problem. What is the problem? The problem is if I need to solve a partial differential equation, nonlinear, etc., and I need to solve this for any possible parameter, defining the material, defining the geometry, and defining the boundary conditions, the loads, there are millions of problems to be solved. So, conceptually, it's very easy. We need to solve for any choice of the parameters, and as soon as I compute all these millions of solutions, I store in my computer, and now, in the online step, as soon as I need a solution, I go to my computer, I extract the solution, and I use it. So, everything is easy, but I need too much time, even if offline is too much. And too much is too much, even in Spain. So, the problem is, this is very nice, but I cannot pre-compute any possible scenario because the number of them increase exponentially with the number of parameters in the model. And even if offline, we cannot solve 10 power 12 3D problems, nor linear, transient, etc. So I need to compute it, but in an alternative way. And this alternative way is illustrated in this slide, in which all the ideas appear, and after we are only to apply these ideas to some practical cases. Imagine the heat equation that is parametric, because in this heat equation the conductivity, that is in red, indicates that this is the parameter, and in blue we have the coordinates. And obviously, I'm interested in solving the heat equation to compute the temperature field at each position, at each time, for any value of this parameter, or for a given value of this parameter. And the problem is, as soon as this k change, I need to solve again. And this is the traditional way to solve parametric models. In general, I solve many, many times for each value of the parameter. An alternative approach, that is the one that we are considering, but is not the only approach. There are others. This is not the best. This is not the worst. It's one of them. Is to consider that the parameter that was in red, because was a parameter, now is in blue, and it becomes a coordinate, like the space, like the time. This is nice, because this means that I would like to compute the temperature field at each position, at each time instant, and for any value of k, x is defined in a domain, t is defined in an interval, and k is defined in the interval in which I would like to compute my parametric solution. What is the problem? The problem is, this approach is very nice. We are changing parameters by coordinates, and by solving a problem that before was 2D and now is 3D, so it's more expensive, it's more complex, I could obtain this solution that is a parametric solution and is this kind of vademecums that I presented in the first slide. So the idea is to compute this. In this case, it's not so complicated, because finally we are moving from a 2D, that is very easy, to a 3D that is not so complicated. But the problem is, if now we are adding the more and more parameters as coordinates, here I have a lot of coordinates, and my problem is not 3D, my problem is 10D, 20D, 50D, 100D, and finally, probably, solving a problem in 100 dimensions is so difficult that solving millions of 3D problems. So, the idea is nice, but it's not so clear, because finally we change a complexity, the number of problems to be solved, in another complexity, that is the solution of a high-dimensional problem. So, okay, nice, but this is not clear. Okay, this is here, nice again, but we need to solve problems, highly dimensional, and this is not easy. Okay, this is not easy, but there is one possibility, is instead of considering a mesh in this high-dimensional space, that is impossible, because the number of degrees of freedom increase exponentially with the dimensions. If you are in 1D, you have n, in 2D, you have n squared, in 3D, you have n cubed, and if you are in 10 dimensions, you have n power 10. So finally, the degrees of freedom is increasing exponentially, and you cannot construct a mesh in a space of dimension 10, 20, 50. So we need another representation. I'm changing only the representation. Instead of approximating my function by using a mesh in a high-dimensional space, I'm approximating my function by using the separation of variables, that this is something very, very old, that is coming from the Fourier's time. And in this case, I write that my temperature that depends on X, T, and K can be write as a sum of functions that depends only on X, functions that depends only on T, functions that depends only on K, and I don't know these functions, I don't know these ones, I don't know these ones. But if I find an algorithm able to compute these functions and these functions, this is nice, because a sequence of 1D, 1D, and 1D, we obtain the solution of a 3D. Okay, I agree with you. For solving a 3D problem, it's not necessary to use this, because a 3D, we can solve without this strategy. But if you are in a problem of dimension 10, you cannot solve it by using a mesh, and you can solve a sequence of many one-dimensional problems. So, this is all. I'm using the same weak forms, I'm using the same equations, I'm using everything similar. The only thing that I'm changing is an approximation based on a mesh that does not run in a high-dimensional space, by an approximation that is constructed by using this separation of variables that we use when we were young in the high school for solving partial differential equations. The algorithm, I don't need to tell the algorithm because today it's very well known. If you are interested in some information, please send me an email. But it's quite easy. At the beginning, I look for the first term, a function of x, a function of time, a function of k. The three are unknown. And I suppose that these two are known. I take arbitrarily at the first iteration. And if I take this, I assume this given, arbitrarily given, I can compute this one because I have only a one-dimensional problem. From this one that I just compute, and from this one I compute T, from T and X I compute K, and I come back to the beginning because I'm solving a nonlinear problem until reaching the convergence. So it's very easy. It's a sequence of one-dimensional problems by using a fixed point algorithm, an alternated direction fixed point algorithm. And as soon as converge, I compute the first term in this sum, I move to the second one, and I use again, I consider these two known, I compute this, from this and this I compute this, from this and this I compute this, and I come back from this and this I compute this, and I iterate until the convergence. So finally, in your code, you have a sequence, two loops, one loop for enriching, and one loop for solving the nonlinearity, and inside, only the simulation, only the solution of very low dimensional partial differential equations, 1D, 2D, 3D, and this is all. Okay, this runs, and I would like to move to the applications. And the first one concerns something that is related to a vademecum for welding. Why? Because we are very interested in applying a source, a thermal source. This thermal source is moving because you are welding with a velocity V, and the thickness of these two plates could change. The thickness of this one is C1 and the thickness of this one is C2. And in order to compute a parametric solution, I would like to compute the solution, the temperature field, at each point, X, Y, and Z, is 3D. For each possible velocity, the velocity was a parameter, but now it's a coordinate. For each source term, that was a parameter, but now it's a coordinate. And for any thickness of this plate, and for any thickness of this plate. That before were geometrical parameters, and now are two extra coordinates. So more than solving plenty of problems, I'm solving only one time in my life a problem in dimension 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. But in order to compute the solution, I apply this algorithm, the separation of variables, and I compute functions of space, functions of velocity, functions of the power, functions of this thickness, functions of this thickness, and by solving three 3D problems, I have access to the solution in 7 dimensions. Okay, this is nice, and this is the result. You can appreciate that now that the solution is compute, you can change online the velocity,
the power, the thinness, and instantaneously you have the temperature field, because now online we are only exploring, particularizing this parametric solution. This is nice because in this case we work in the frame attached to the source, but sometimes we cannot, because it's not equivalent to move the source or to move the part. And everybody knows, in particular Sergio, that a moving load is difficult to separate in order to apply the strategy that I just described, and we propose to use a technique in which, more than using standard adaptativity, in order to follow the source along the part to perform the welding, we are enriching this standard coarse finite element approximation with an enrichment function that should be accurate enough to represent locally the rich solution. And the problem is, this is nice, we are enriching in the framework of the partition of unity, in the framework of the generalized finite element method, but I need the function to enrich locally my solution. And I would like to use only one, because my interest is to move very, very fast, close to real time. And for this purpose, we define, and this will be explained by Diego tomorrow, around the source term in which everything is localized, we are solving a very rich parametric model in which we can assume that the power is a parameter, the velocity of the laser, for example, is a parameter, and also the boundary conditions are parameters. We are solving the temperature heat, the temperature field, in this representative volume that is very close and is following the source, for any velocity, and for any boundary condition. In the case of this image, there are a polynomial of degree 4 here, 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 and here. So you have 16 parameters related to the boundary conditions. You have the velocity, you have the flux, and you have the space. So you have a problem in dimension 20 or more. You apply this algorithm in order to construct this very rich separator representation. And now, online, when I'm at this point, I look for the temperature in the border, I particularize the parametric solution, and I use it to enrich my solution within the framework of the generalized finite element. When the source is moving, if I arrive in this region in which the boundary conditions are different, I particularize again my vademecum. This is real time. I know which is the best enrichment function. I inject this in the generalized finite element, and I can compute with a very coarse grid very accurate solutions, and by speeding up the calculations some orders of magnitude. So this is very nice, and even you can change the power or you can change the velocity if in a certain moment the laser accelerates or increase or decrease the power. So, very nice, this is a kind of a smart general finite element method, because I'm enriching with one function, only one, but the best, the one that verifies the real boundary conditions, the real power, and the real velocity. And it represents very well the solution that is localized, and we don't need to remesh in this region in order to obtain the solution. And you can compare here the solution that we obtain with this technique when you compare with the core finite elements method. Obviously, you can appreciate the gap. And you can also appreciate that if we solve without the adaptation of this enrichment function using this vademecum, there is some gap in the point in which you have the singularity, the localization of the solution. And on the contrary, by adapting the enrichment function, you obtain a solution that is exactly than the reference one that you could compute in a very fine mesh. So finally, we obtain very, very accurate solutions by enriching with only one function, but we choose very well this function, and in order to choose it, we compute a very rich parametric solution around the region in which the solution localizes. Last point, there are only how many time? 5 minutes? Okay. I will move to another thing, that is the simulation in real time for process control, and this case is machining. This is the kind of shells that appears in the aircraft, and in general I like, the people likes to remove a little bit of metal in order to reduce the weight. But obviously we need to remove the adequate quantity or amount of matter. We cannot remove too much, if not it's very dangerous. And the problem is, when we start the process, finally we don't know the geometry. Oh no, the geometry, no, more or less is like this. But we don't know exactly what is the geometry. Why? Because the geometry finally depends on all the previous formal process, all the residual stresses, and even the clamping conditions of this shell to the tool. So finally the geometry is not very well known, and so it's very difficult machining by removing a constant thickness in the part. So in general, classically, people propose, this is the nominal part, the life is beautiful, the reality is beautiful, and they imagine the trajectory. After, they measure the real geometry. Wow, this takes a time, yes. And time is money, yes. And so, after measuring, okay, the real is not the nominal. Okay, don't worry. We adapt the nominal to the real geometry and we start machining. Oh, yes, but this is expensive. Could we remove it? Is the question of people in industry. And the answer is yes, if we can proceed very fast. And this means I start from the nominal and I would like, at the same time that I'm machining the part, I would like to adjust the position of the tool. And this is easy. I don't know. One possibility, for example, is for the tool, we introduce a laser in order to measure the surface. The problem is, if this is high-speed machining, you cannot compute, you have no time to compute and to send the information to the machine. So we need to predict the whole geometry and not only predict the geometry 3 centimeters from the tool. And in order to perform this, obviously, one possibility is the tool is moving, the laser arrives to the plate, but the tool is not in the plate, it starts measuring, and we can detect that the nominal and the nominal path is not the same that the real, and we can adjust the real geometry. But we need to perform very, very fast. And we need to perform very fast, making a prediction on the whole part and not only in the 3 centimeters that are just before the tool. And one idea to perform this is, okay, we can generate plenty of geometries, yes, with your simulator. You take Abacus and you can generate plenty of surfaces. Or even you can take all the surfaces that exist in the industry. You can measure, and finally you have a kind of snapshots that represent all the possible geometries. As there is a lot of information, I apply the SVD, and the SVD select the most significant modes. There are only R, not N, only R. Here there are thousands, and here maybe there are 5 or 6. And after, if we truncate the POD with a small enough threshold value, we can assume that any surface is a combination, a linear combination of these 5. This means that if I determine only 5 coefficients that are the alpha coefficients, I could predict the whole geometry. And I need only 5 informations in order to make this. And this means that by using the laser, we can measure the surface, we can predict the real surface, the whole surface, and obviously, as we are measuring during the process, I could check and if needed, I could update. So this is nice, and they run in real time, even for high-speed machines. When there are stresses, residual stresses, and the plate is very small, the thickness is very small, this is complicated because when removing the matter, there is a disequilibrium in the residual stresses and the plate deflect. Oh, and I need to, I don't know what are the residual stresses. This is unknown. It's impossible. It's very expensive to have access to this. And I would like to start the machine to identify the residual stresses and with this make a prediction on the future. Oh, nice. But this is easy. I don't know. But this is the proof that experimentally when you are removing matter, you are deflecting and you need to adjust again the toolpath in order to make a nice machining. And the idea for this was again the vademecum. As I don't know the residual stresses, I approximate it by a polynomial, an auto-equilibrated polynomial, because residual stresses are auto-equilibrated, like in the Treff polynomials. And these coefficients, etc. I don't know what are the values of this. So I consider that all these values are parameters, so are coordinates of my model. And I'm solving which is the deflection of my plate during the time at each position for any possible residual stress inside. Wow! And it runs. Yes. You start, you apply the same algorithm, you obtain this, and after you can particularize the solution, and we are reproducing the deformation of my plate when we are machining only one pocket or four pockets in this case. And this means, as at all the solution, this vademecum, this parametric solution is known, now, during the machining, I could identify the displacement, I could identify the residual stresses, and I could predict what happens in the surface during the time until the end. So in this case, it's exactly the same, but more than having a surface, we have an evolution of the surface in the time for any possible residual stresses. We can obtain the reduced basis, we can approximate by a low-dimensional polynomial, and after, this is the proof. It's incredible, but it's run. Probably it's a miracle. We are checking it because it's the first time that simulations give this kind of results that is too accurate. So finally, this is all for my presentation. The main conclusions are in our approach, in the approach that we are developing, in particular in Nantes, in collaboration with Barcelona, with Antonio and Pedro, and with Elias Cueto in Zaragoza, we are considering that the parameters, more than parameters, are coordinates. Why not? The problem that appears is high dimensional. Don't worry, we are using the separation of variables. That is something that is quite classical. And we only introduce this in an algorithm, in a computer. And as soon as you compute this parametric solution that we call the vademecum, the life is wonderful. Because now you can imagine that as soon as you have a request, you go to these solutions, you identify in real time all the parameters that you need. And like this, you can compute in real time, like in this problem that we are controlling in real time, you can perform optimization in real time, you can perform homogenization FE2, you can imagine that you are solving for any possible history of the thermomechanical history. And as well as you have this kind of high-dimensional, very rich parametric solution, the life is wonderful because all the work was made offline. It's not too much because finally this algorithm of the separation of variables runs quite well. And after you can make plenty of things, you can make plenty of dreams in real time, and you are obtaining very nice solutions. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much for this lecture, lively as ever.
Wow.